Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. And I hope everyone had a great summer. I'll remind members and witnesses to ensure that all their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. And I'll just say apologies because I've got a new gadget and I'm not quite sure how to turn the notifications off. I'd like to welcome our new member, Pam Gosal, to the committee. And to invite her to declare any relevant interests. Pam.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you, Chair. I have no declaration of interest.
Thanks very much. And I'd like to invite other members who might have any relevant interests. Marie and Mark.
Thank you, Chair. Can I direct members to my registered interests as a former councillor in Western Berkshire up until 2022?
Thank you, Convener. This is the first committee meeting since my register of interest has changed, so just to put it on record that I have ceased being an owner of a private entity property and a landlord, but advised by the standards clerk that I must make that declaration for a year following cessation of the declaration.
Okay. Thanks very much for doing that. Our second item is to decide whether to take items 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are members agreed? Great, we're all agreed. Thank you. We now turn to agenda item 3, which is to take evidence on our post-legislative scrutiny of the Community Empowerment Act in 2015. We recently concluded an inquiry into part 2 of the Act. Part 2 is concerned with community planning, and the Scottish Government has now published its response to our inquiry report. That was the fourth part of the Act looked at by this committee or our predecessor. This committee has also looked at Part 9 on allotments, and our predecessor committee looked at Part 3 on participation requests and Part 5 on asset transfers. Each of those are important elements in empowering communities, and so today we're taking the opportunity to reflect on what progress has been made across all four areas of the inquiry, and we are joined in person to do that work by Tom Arthur, who's the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance, and Joe Fitzpatrick, who's the Minister for Local Government Empowerment and Planning. And the ministers are joined by the Scottish Government officials Andrew Connell, who's the Community Planning and Public Service Reform Team Leader, and Kathleen Glazik, who is the Community Empowerment Team Leader. We're also joined this morning online by Councillor Stephen Heddle, who's the Vice President of the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, often referred to as COSLA. And Councillor Heddle is supported this morning online by Garrick Smith, who is the Policy Manager of the Workforce and Corporate Policy Team at COSLA. I'd like to welcome you all to the committee. And we have a number of questions, as you can imagine, and I will start. The first question. So the evidence that we heard during our inquiry into community planning from community organisations, particularly communities of interest, was a lot less positive than the evidence from public bodies about the extent of the shift of power towards communities. 8 years on, how successful has the Act been in shifting power towards communities? That's something we'd be interested to hear your reflections on. And in answering that question, it would also be helpful to hear if you could set out what you understand community to mean and, moreover, what community empowerment looks like to you. And I think I'm going to start with the Minister for Community Wealth and Public Finance on that one.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the committee. On the specific points around community planning partnerships, I will leave that for my colleague Mr. Fitzpatrick to respond to on behalf of the government as the lead minister. But with regards to the broader question of community, of course we have recognised terms, whether it be community of place or community of interest, but I think what's paramount is ensuring that communities have that space to define themselves and to understand themselves, and as such be able to engage with public services through that shared understanding that they have developed of their own identity as a community. And that's something I take very seriously, both in the work I'm leading on community wealth building and indeed the work more widely around community empowerment, whether that be through participation requests, asset transfers, the wider work we're doing around the review of the Community Empowerment Act, and also the work that we're undertaking on the review of local governance, that key word being governance, not government. And of course, working with communities is going to be paramount to that, and exploring in partnership with COSLA ways in which we can empower communities further and place more resources and decision-making power in the hands of communities. But part of that is being able to recognise that communities have a role in being able to define themselves and how they understand themselves, and finding the models and the range of powers and levers that are best suited to their particular needs.
Thanks very much for that. And Joe, do you want to come in on the community planning aspects?
Yeah, I think it is really important that the points that Mr. Arthur made in terms of engagement with the wider community and getting people involved, I think that's really important. But ultimately, it is the responsibility of the community planning partnerships to identify the measures that they need to in order to assess whether the work that they're doing, their partnerships, are having an effect. I think from a Scottish Government's perspective, you know, we don't currently commission research to look at that abstract of what impact does community planning partnerships have in the round. I think that would be quite a difficult exercise to take forward. I think it would be difficult to measure some of the positive aspects of community planning partnerships. The most important thing about the bill, the Act, was that it put these partnerships on a statutory footing, whereas previously they were not. I think that's a good thing. It's really important that when we're measuring how effective the actions that we're taking, that the partners who have responsibility are making sure that they measure the outcomes appropriately, so that we can assess not whether the partnership is working, but whether the actions that the partnership are taking and driving forward are having the impacts on the communities. And I think it says something that the very first part of your question was about those marginalised communities, because sometimes it is so easy to say we're doing all this amazing work and because all the people who are around the table are connected, but it's often the people who are not around the table that are most needing the support of the community planning partnership. So that's why we need to continually assess to make sure we're doing that correctly, and if we see particular gaps, then look at how we address them. So one of the areas where we know there was a particular gap was around gypsy and traveller communities. And so we've now taken action to make sure that we now know how to and have the tools to engage meaningfully with that community on their terms, not on our terms, not an engagement on the terms of a particular part of a partnership or the Scottish Government or even this committee, but on their terms.
Okay, thanks very much for that. It's interesting that in the Verity House Agreement, I think that's the first time I've been able to say that in public, the Verity House Agreement, the community planning partnerships, it says that the community planning partnerships will be recognised as a critical mechanism for alignment of resource locally, focused on prevention and early intervention, and it goes on. But I think the important piece is that you know, in the agreement between COSLA and the Scottish Government, community planning partnerships are really being focused on or kind of, you know, central. And so I'd be interested to hear what you think, you know, where does the role of community, if we haven't got it, I mean, the committee's kind of brought forward a number of proposals and ideas about how we can improve community planning partnerships. If there are things that need to be done to address those things, how do we get communities really having a voice through community planning partnerships in the New Deal that's been agreed?
So I think, first of all, the New Deal is much wider than the Verity House Agreement. The Verity House Agreement is one of the planks of the New Deal. So I think that's the two things are not the same. So there's a lot of work still ongoing in terms of delivering the New Deal with local government. But the Verity House Agreement is a really important partnership agreement between the two spheres of government, the Scottish Government and our local government partners. And it's absolutely correct that within that there's a recognition both from Scottish Government and COSLA about the important role of community planning partnerships. So it is really important that's there, right at the centre and within that agreement between the Scottish Government and local government.
Okay, thanks very much. Councillor Heddle, I'd like to bring you in on the question around how do you think the Act has been, how successful do you think the Act's been 8 years on in shifting the power to communities? Also, your thoughts on what is community? What does community empowerment look like to you? And then also, how do we ensure that through this Verity House agreement that really puts the community planning partnerships in a central role, how do we make sure that communities have a voice in this new deal?
Yes, and thanks, Chair. Apologies for my croaky voice. I've got a sore throat today. I think the Act obviously has made a difference, and I mean, that's not an assertion. I think that's recognised by independent bodies assessing it as well, such as the Local Government Information Unit. And the change in emphasis on who is empowered or obliged to participate in terms of the partners, you know, widen this from essentially councils and health being the lead into the police and fire and the enterprise agencies, I think has been very positive. And also we've seen a good number of community asset transfers, and they absolutely welcome the existence of the participation requests. I think it's clear that we could do more to make people aware of how they can participate. And there is clearly a lot of work that's ongoing in terms of this from the local governance review, and note the launch of Democracy Matters 2, the six-month conversation to encourage more community participation, which was just launched last Monday. Obviously, in terms of engagement with the communities, I think we want to also emphasise the best practice that we can carry forward, and we have the various fora in which we can do that in terms of the Community Planning Improvement Board, Community Planning Network, and the third sector interface. Empowerment, I think, runs through this. I mean, the local governance reviews, but the three empowerments, functional, fiscal and community, and the whole aspect of that permeates the Verity House agreement, obviously more of which later. I mean, just to perhaps preempt the conversation in that, a lot of the principles in the Verity House Agreement are based on the European Charter of Local Self-Government, and the subsidiarity is key in this, the taking decisions at the most appropriate level closest to the community. And, you know, that's something that in local government we realise is incumbent on us. At the very same time as we speak to the Scottish Government about the transfer of empowerment in the three ways from the Scottish Government. In terms of what community means, I think the ministers have defined it in probably the similar way to how I would, so I'm not labour the point any further.
Good, great. Thank you very much. And I just want to say that I'm admiring your backdrop and with the pointer that shows us where you are. Thanks for that orientation. Yeah, exactly. Okay, I'd like to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Chair. Just sticking to, obviously, the subject on community participation and empowerment, it's described, as you've probably heard, as more a tick box exercise. And just diving a little bit more into this, that it's said that there's a lack of visibility on the community planning partnership in the wider community, and it's clear that there's certain groups feel that their voices are not being heard. So will the Scottish Government take this opportunity during its review of Part 2 of the Act to help renew CPPS's focus on the importance of empowerment and participation through identifying opportunities to drive improvement and shared best practice? Could I ask the Minister?
Yeah, I think we know for sure there is some really good practice going on out there, which is why, and it's important that that is shared across Scotland. I think it's also important to remember that we would not expect all community planning partnerships to look the same. By definition, they are going to be impacted by their locality, their communities, so there will be a degree of variability, but it's, I think, reasonable to assume that we should be trying to drive up standards and effectiveness of those of all CPPs, and I don't think that should be a top-down thing in terms of us telling CPPs what to do and how to operate, but it's about making sure that the platforms exist for sharing that best practice and also looking at whether there is then a need to adjust guidance at some point in the future as well. So the bodies that the Scottish Government work with collaboratively in order to make sure we are sharing that best practice. Obviously, COSLA is as the other arm of government with a very close interest, but crucially also the Community Planning Improvement Board, and that is really, really important. Looking, it's a product of the pandemic, but its role, I think, is still really useful in terms of bringing together people from across CPPs in order to make sure that we are sharing that best practice, and also the community planning network that Councillor Heddle mentioned as well. Using those bodies, I think we can then make sure that we are sharing that best practice, and you know, if discussions around that would suggest that there's a need to update guidance, then that's something we can look at too. But I think it is important that we don't ever suggest that we've got community empowerment, community planning right, and that's the box ticked. We need to continue looking at how they operate and how they represent the communities. In terms of some of the communities, I've kind of engaged with some people who, when you speak about the CPP, their initial response is, well, we don't really have any engagement with the CPP. And obviously the CPP is not an entity in itself, it's a body of its parts. And if we drill down, then often you find out that many of the partners of the CPP are engaging directly. And maybe there's a bit for us for those partners to think how better they can articulate how that feeds back into the CPP, those connections, whether it's with the police, with the fire, with the local council, or with the third sector interface. But there's no one suggesting that everything's perfect and we can't make improvements. I think everyone in the sphere wants to do more and recognises that we are on a journey and we can make this better.
Chair, could I come back with a follow-up, please? It's good to hear that obviously you're working with many partners. The two of the areas that it would be good to hear from yourself, from both ministers, it would be really good, is one on digital divide, because we all know that it's so hard, basically, for people out there that have that digital poverty that they can't ultimately participate in democracy. So how would you be looking to basically work on that? That's one. And the second thing that obviously I've spoke a lot about in my last committee is about the outreach, and making sure that we are reaching out to all those communities, whether it's disability or whether it's BAME communities. So how are you looking to basically go and reach out to them and encourage them to participate and empower those communities?
I'll pass over to Tom in a minute to kind of talk about the Democracy Matters conversation, which goes beyond digital. Obviously, there's a big digital part to that, but it does go beyond that. But in terms of reaching those communities who don't normally engage, I think it is so important. So Tom will be able to talk about how, in terms of Democracy Matters, some of the partners that are helping make us make sure we get there. But I think it is the responsibility of all CPP partners to make sure that, not just in their work as part of the CPP, but in all of their work, they're statutory members for a reason, and they have a responsibility to make sure that they are engaging across our varied and diverse communities. And that's how we'll get things right, by having that meaningful engagement in everything they do. And I think that is perhaps, we were going to talk about the successes of CPPs, and maybe that is one of the successes. It's not really measurable as such, it's difficult to report, but the recognition of all of the partners about their role to engage with all parts of the community, I think, is in a better place than it would have been if it wasn't for the CPPs.
Could I ask the same question to Councillor Stephen, please?
Okay, we'll bring in Councillor Heddle, and then Tom can come in with his part too.
Yeah, thanks very much for that question. I mean, I really hope that empowerment isn't a kick box exercise, because, I mean, if we have one job, it's to serve our communities. Well, clearly, this always sort of compromised by the resources and manpower we have available to try and do everything that we would like to do. But, I mean, in terms of the community voices not being heard, I would acknowledge that this is probably true. And I would say it's not solely the fault of the community planning partnerships. I mean, it's a function of inequality, which we need to address through all our policy areas. And I think there's also an issue of voices not so much not being heard, it's not being expressed. And it's what can we do to reach out to help people express their voice and subsequently be heard. And I mean, this works obviously across the a number of the things that we highlight, you know, locality plans, local police plans in terms of planning. There's the risk that the communities who are well-resourced in terms of the time and money can shout louder than the impoverished communities who lack both of these things. So it's how we can help them. I think it's a question that has to permeate all of our thinking. As the Minister said, this is something that we need to consider alongside our partners, and I acknowledge the help that we get from our partners in the community planning partnerships, notably in my own area, the Third Sector Interface, who have developed the community engagement principles that all our community planning partners use, and have conducted a number of exercises that physically goes to every area of our community, which is in Orkney's dispersed over 20 inhabited islands. We need to get it better. And as mentioned before, the best practice and sharing of best practice is absolutely something that we have to do, and we have various vehicles and through which we can do that.
Thanks very much. Tom, did you want to come back in?
Just briefly to build upon what's already been said, point around digital divide is very well made, and of course that's why we employ a multitude of different channels for engaging with individuals, with communities collectively. When we jointly launched the Democracy Matters Phase 2 conversation last week, it was an in-person event with a range of stakeholders present. So recognising that need to make sure that we are not just relying upon one means of communication engagement is important, and that informs all of our approach to wider engagement. The point ensuring all voices are heard, I think, is absolutely paramount. It is of such importance. And I come back to that point I was making earlier with regards to response to the question of how we define a community. I think we'll all be conscious from our engagement in our respective constituencies and regions that there can be voices which purport to be the voice of a community, but that would be contested by other people within the wider community, and that is something that we always have to bear in mind. So ensuring that the fullest range of voices are heard is important, and not just from a perspective of inclusion or equality or rights, but ensuring that we can harness that collective expertise, knowledge, insight and lived experience that exists across our community and bring that to bear. It's not just a failing of inclusion if these voices are not included, it's a missed opportunity to bring that knowledge and insight, as I say, to bear. And that particular unique set of experiences that different groups will bring. And often we can find that some of the groups who can be perhaps historically have perhaps been most marginalised in the democratic process are often those who engage most frequently with public services, and in such can bring a very powerful set of insights to that conversation. So yes, we do it from a perspective of principles of inclusivity and equality, but we also want to do it so we're bringing that collective expertise of our communities to bear so we can all benefit from it.
Thanks very much for that. We're now going to move on to a bit more detailed topic on community planning, and Miles Briggs has
got questions. Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ministers. Good morning to the panel as well. I think on two occasions when you've both been at committee, you've outlined just how much third sector has played an important role in our communities, and especially during the pandemic. And I know in the evidence session to the committee, the Community Planning Minister acknowledged that there are places where the third sector involvement is not happening in Scotland. Now, our report recommended a new requirement for CPPs to invite the third sector to engage in community planning, and the government's not accepted that recommendation. So can I ask, what do both ministers intend to do to try to make sure our third sector are really part of the conversation going forward?
Yeah, so I think you're quoting me, and if I suggested that it wasn't happening at all anywhere, then I think that was probably an unfair thing for me to have said. I'm not sure it was what I said. Clearly, in some areas, there is particularly good practice. So I think a couple of examples I'm aware of is Argyll and Bute, Perth and Ross. There's a particularly good interface there with the third sector. So clearly, there's examples of how, you know, I think in at least one of those locations, the third sector actually shares the chair. But I think, and I could be wrong, but I think all CPPs do involve the third sector. But can that be done better? Can there be more? I think so. I think the current guidance provides the flexibility for that to be done in a way which works for the different localities. And again, I think we need to be careful not to be saying, well, this works really well in Perth and Kinross, so therefore you should all follow this model and government to instruct in that way. And that just wouldn't be appropriate. But it is appropriate that we make sure that we are sharing best practice. So again, the CPIB are the body that helps us do that, along with the community planning network, and I think it's absolutely right that the third sector is involved in there as part of that. I think the pandemic showed that CPPs have created the connections which give resilience in at that time of the pandemic, and so I think it is important. We, in terms of delivery of some of these things during the pandemic, could not have been achieved without a good interface with the third sector. So because of the work of the CPPs, I think the connections were already made, so there wasn't a need to bring everyone around the table in order to be able to deliver for communities. So I'm not suggesting that every CPP has it right, but I am suggesting that it would be wrong of us to impose particular models. But I think the committee's comments are heard. They're heard by Greg Colgan, chair of CPIB, who will help us look at all of the guidance. And you know, if there's a feeling that there's a need for us to refresh some of that guidance, then we'll do that. If we feel there's a need to, once we've had those conversations, including looking at the work of this committee, which, you know, you took a huge range of evidence, which is really, really helpful. You know, it may be that we decide that there's a need for a short-term working group in order to look at how we improve the guidance to make sure we help encourage best practice everywhere.
Yeah, it's good to hear that you're willing to look at that. I do think kind of our evidence did point towards some sort of formalised role being needed. And actually, on another committee I sat on with regards to integrated joint boards, one of the lessons was not including the third sector in their work had actually prevented some progress as well. So interested to see, as the Minister said earlier, I think we're missing an opportunity not including the third sector. So to try to have a formalised role, I think, would be helpful. One of the keys to that is actually community engagement expertise. And I know that in our evidence, local authorities, and Councillor Heddle, I think you pointed us towards this, didn't necessarily have the leadership skills around collaboration. So I wanted to ask specifically where the panel believe that community engagement is indeed a professional skill set, and what work will be done to help develop those skills, given in many councils there maybe aren't resources to deliver these individuals to work or training. Councillor Heddle, I pointed towards what you said last time, so maybe bring you in.
Yeah, sorry, just checking I was unmuted there. Thanks very much. And before I specifically answer the question, can I just maybe perhaps add some further examples of best practice that's underway? Because I think Dumfries and Galloway, we believe that the third sector interface officers chair and support their four locality hubs, which is geographic forums in their structure. Perth and Kinross has been mentioned in South Ayrshire. We understand that the TSI is an active member of the Community Planning Board and has representation across the partnerships, strategic delivery partnerships. And in my own area, the Voluntary Action Orkney, our local TSI, is a leader of one of the thematic groups. And, you know, we very much value their support. And, I mean, in terms of the change in the Act, we don't feel that a change in Act in the Act itself would be necessary. And, you know, if we're cautious in terms of that, it's because we feel it might limit the local flexibility in terms of ensuring the best vehicle for engagement with the third sector. I would absolutely value the work of the CPIB and agree that a change in guidance would be most appropriate and would support the Minister's suggestion for a short-term working group if that was to take place. In terms of leadership, whether leadership in community planning or leadership in general is a professional skill, I think the way that we can support this at present is through things like the role of the Scottish Leaders Forum in support and collaborative leadership in the public sector. In terms of the support and leadership within the Community Planning Partnership, I think there's a degree of mutuality there that people should be expected to help bring each other along, and that would be a valuable thing, both in terms of understanding shared perspectives, but also, just development within the Community Planning Partnership itself.
Thanks. Does anyone else want to come in on that point?
In terms of leadership, I'm probably agree with what Councillor Heddle has said. Maybe just add in a couple of examples. I think part of the issue is I think we need to make sure that it's not just assumed that always the local authority will be the provider of leadership, because I think that's not always the case. And I've got a couple of examples from recent visits that I've taken where there was other skills brought to bear. So I think one I mentioned last time was Westleigh Hales Community. In terms of producing their local place plan, they supplemented the skill set that they and the local authority had using consultancy, and that worked for them, and it gave the community more independence, I guess, than it being a local authority person that was taking that leadership role. And the other community I visited, one of the communities I visited during my summer tour, was the Struan community on Skye, who are looking at repurposing a building as a community asset for the future. And they pulled in the support of Planning Aid Scotland to help them supplement the skills they had. But to be fair, that community was pretty rich in terms of the skills they had around the table. So I think again, it's maybe not a one size fits all, but I think what we need to try and avoid doing is assuming that this leadership role should always be one that is from either government, either national or local level, because sometimes that would be potentially removing the independence of the community.
I'm actually just going to come back and get into a little bit of granular detail there. So it's great to hear you recognise the importance of the skill sets around the table. But I think that one of the things that we were getting at in or what kind of came to light when we were doing this work, gathering this evidence, was really about some kind of acknowledgement that community engagement is a professional skill, and that that needs to be resourced. And whether that's within the local authorities or, you know, third sector or wherever, that we need to really start recognising that, because there's so much work that needs to be done in Scotland right now in the face of the changes that we need to be making, where those facilitation skills, those engagement skills are crucial. And we talked earlier in the conversation about how do we... it's not just about... So voices that are not being heard, but also Councillor Heddle pointed out, how do we actually create that space where people can actually feel comfortable and safe to express themselves? So I do think that is a professional skill set, that, and we need to recognise that. We need to give resource to that. And that's not about dictating what it will look like on a local level, but it means we have to get out of this. And I know that we are challenged in Scotland generally with the budget and situation, but we have to get out of this. I think that we need to start looking at how do we get that soft infrastructure in place in Scotland so that we have people who are there, able to work in communities with that engagement, with that facilitation, and that communities are not trapped in the cycle of 1 year funding for those people. And that 1 year, as you well know, is not even, right, that 1 year is taken up with report, getting the money in the first place and then having to report. So I think there's something there that we maybe need to continue the conversation on, but I'd be interested to hear your initial thoughts on that.
So I definitely agree with what you're saying. I think the West of Hales community's experience is one that the committee might find valuable in terms of hearing their experience. It was obviously a community which has been particularly deprived, a lot of marginalised parts of that community, and so their experience in producing one of the first new style local place plans in the country that's been agreed by the council, so it has that new status. So I think they're maybe one of many communities who are showing the way for others, but. So I think that's possibly worth looking at.
Thank you.
I would only add 2 points. First, it would, of course, be remiss of us not to recognise the huge contribution that many of our partner organisations, such as DTA, Scottish Community Development Centre, and many others who have been supported by the Scottish Government, provide directly to communities. The second point is I very much recognise the concerns you express with regards to the funding environment in which we operate in. And I think we can all understand it was a cascading effect that occurs from when budgets are set by the UK government, and the impact that has upon our ability to forward plan, and the impact that then has upon local government and other partner organisations, as much as we seek to provide a degree of certainty or confidence through medium-term financial strategies and indicative budgets. But I do recognise that point, and also the specific challenge around resourcing to provide that level of engagement we want to see. But I think it's also important to bear in mind that when we speak about engagement, for example, with local government, there's an element of almost additionality, doing something additional. And part of the agenda of empowerment, of the review of local governance, of moving to a more participatory form of democracy, is where it's no longer viewed as something as additional, but is integrated and as part of the approach. And analogously, with community wealth building, thinking about that aspect, the economic element, the democratising of our economy, again, some of the narrative is about that being something additional. And indeed, it does require additional support in that transitional phase. But the destination is for something that is much more integrated and mainstream. So I think it's an important point to make as well. But notwithstanding it, I reckon these are medium to long-term aspirations that we'll seek to advance, of course, in partnership. There is that continued need for support in the immediate term.
Yeah, I would agree with you. I think that's absolutely what we need right now, is that it's that transition that we're going through as we move to fulfil the aspirations of the community empowerment agenda. And it's like, how do we get there? And it's having that additional support there. Councillor Heddle, did you want to come in on anything there, or shall we move on? Happy to move on. Okay, super.
No, sorry, I was...
Oh, you are coming in. All right, okay, that was... Go on.
This is this new Zoom environment.
I know, right?
Don't know what the rules are. Yes, I was just going to generally support what Mr. Fitzpatrick and Mr. Arthur have been saying there, and you know, particularly around the fact that the resourcing of the community planning partnerships isn't something that solely has to come or should come from local government. It's the totality of the resource from the partners. And it's a matter of enabling all the partners, including local government, to have the financial flexibility to be able to do this. I mean, in general, we are not in favour of ring-fenced allocation supports of money, because we don't think that allows us the flexibility to deliver best value across all the service areas that we have to do. And this is the case here as well. We wouldn't support a directed budget towards this. We would support, certainly, guidance to all partners as to how the community planning partnerships should function and be supported, but it's the financial flexibility to be able to do this. It's the kind of general principle of support in this case.
All right, great, thanks for that. So it seems to be that maybe there needs to be more discussion with all the partners in the CPP in terms of everybody getting involved in how to bring about that improvement in skill sets. I recognise that there are some CPPs where it's working very, very well, and then there are other places where that maybe needs to be, you know, there's like a kind of equivalence that needs to be recognised there in terms of contribution to how the CPPs are run. I'm going to move on, and I'm going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ministers and Council Heddle and officials. It's great to see you here this morning. Really appreciate your time. I'm going to touch on community councils, and obviously they've been around for many years, 50 in fact. What role do you see them having in helping deliver the aspirations of the Verity House Agreement? I'm just going to make two other points. Do you believe legislation should be used to give them an enhanced role in local democracy? And are you confident they're sufficiently representative of the local communities they serve?
Well, thank you very much for the questions, and let me think. Was join all of you in wishing our community councils a very happy 50th birthday, all roughly 1,200 of them across the country. I certainly know from my experience and as a constituency representative the invaluable contribution they make to the communities undertaking a range of different activities, and also providing that important insight and scrutiny to the decisions that not just councillors but their parliamentarians take as well. I think that, and I'll ask Mr. Fitzpatrick wants to come in on any specific aspects of the Verity House Agreement, but I think community councils have a very important role to play. As we undertake this second phase of democracy matters and consider the ways in which further power can be put into the hands of communities, I'm going into that process with no preset ideas of what the outcome should be. Now, that could potentially lead to calls or suggestions for a more enhanced role for community councils. Consciously, I think the committee maybe has been having some interest in the parish council model south of the border and how that links with the quite varied landscape of local government in England, sometimes almost a tripartite structure when you factor in the district and the county. So I'm not going in with any preset ideas about what the future of community council should be. What I think is absolutely imperative is this review progresses, is that any of the ideas that are put forward we consider in consultation and in partnership and collaboratively with our partners in local government and with communities. But recognising that there may be various models that will emerge through the review process, and as such, that might seek to enhance an existing structure within community councils, or potentially new models could be brought forward as well. But I want to reiterate, I think community councils do an invaluable job. I think they make a huge contribution to Scotland collectively. I want to work constructively in a way that we can seek to maximise the impact they have. And if through our deliberations and engagement that we land at a position of an enhanced role for them, potentially in statute, then that is not an option I would be closing off at this stage.
Oh, sorry, Minister.
So I guess that
only bit, I think there was a ask around Verity House agreement, and I guess the kind of main point in terms of the Verity House agreement is there's a commitment to the conclusion of the local governance review is within that. So that would be the main point is the recognition that that needs to be completed within this Parliament.
Thank you, Councillor Heddle. Any kind of points you want to make on community councils?
Yes, thanks. I absolutely believe the community councils have a role in both community empowerment and as envisaged by the Verity House agreement. And, I absolutely hope this is going to be explored to the fullest extent through the Democracy Matters 2 conversation. I also believe that the empowerment of community councils is something that should be explored primarily by local government in line with subsidiarity. I should have declared an instance at the first instance there in saying that I am a former community councillor myself for 4 years before I became a councillor. And in my own area, I think community councils certainly fulfil a very important function. Primarily it's a sounding board for the local members, but also in actually doing things because we resource them in Orkney to an extent and ensure that they have a paid clerk, so they have an administrative function as well. And I mean, I think that's maybe an example of how we could, in a careful way, explore enhancing powers for the community councils, because at present they're limited in what they can do because they cannot be an employer. They have to rely on the local authority to do things for them as a proxy in many cases. They could obviously be more empowered. But I think this is something that should be done carefully, just so that we don't end up closing off perhaps examples of good practice through a prescriptive model which might have unintended consequences.
Okay, back to yourself, Minister.
I just really want to come in and echo and agree with what Councillor Head has said, particularly that point of subsidiarity and recognising local government statutory oversight of community councils, and also again that point Councillor Head made with regards to not taking an overly prescriptive approach and recognising there may be different models that will be suited to different areas. But I think it's very important that we go through this process of the of Democracy Matters, that we are collectively open to what the outcome of that may be. But of course, any next steps that follow from that would be something that would be done consistent with the principles of the Verity House Agreement and close partnership working.
Thank you.
Thanks, Marie. I'm going to move on to questions from Ivan McKee.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I was going to focus on part 9 of the Act, around about allotments, and the committee's inquiry into part 9 suggested some actions for both the Scottish Government and the local authorities round about waiting lists, access to land, integration with wider priorities, sustaining allotments, creation of a national forum and others. I thank the Government for the response to that. We've also taken evidence from some interested groups, Grow Green Scotland, the Glasgow Allotment Forum in particular, who stress a number of frustrations with progress in terms of delivery of the Act on the ground, if you'll excuse the pun. So I'd really just like to explore the Government's perspective on that, if you recognise those frustrations and lack of progress that those groups are citing, and what work and progress has been made more recently to deliver on improvement, access to allotments and community growing spaces.
Thanks for the question. I think part of the frustration, particularly from the groups that you've mentioned, is because we're in a position where the recognition of the value, particularly of community growing, has grown in the last number of years. And we're now seeing increasing numbers of community growing organisations across the country, lots and lots of different models. That work is supported by the Scottish Government. You know, since 2012, we've awarded over £1.8 million to directly support and increase the land that's available for community growing through various grants, fundings. But I visited lots of communities through the summer. Some of them, I was specifically visiting a community growing facility. Others, I was there looking at some regeneration. But very often, even when I was not expecting to be visiting a community growing facility, the organisers would say, well, and there's where we're going to put the community growing facility, or in Shetland, I've forgotten the name of it, but there was a particular structure they were going to do, which was a Shetland-specific polytunnel that was able to withstand the wind, that one of the communities there were showing me where that was going to be fitted. And I think the recognition of the benefits of community growing, in particular allotments, yes, there's absolutely a role for allotments too, but there's this wider movement and a range of community growing organisations ranging from in virtually every community. You know, the benefits of those community growing organisations, I think, need to be fully recognised, because it's not just about the growing of food, which is really important given the current crises that we're facing, but there's the kind of wider benefits in terms of community cohesion, mental health, physical health. There's a education. I visited in Dunoon a community growing scheme there that was just attached to a school. It had been an old school garden. The community growing facility had gone in. They were all properly certified to work with the kids, so the kids were able to come in. And initially, obviously, this is all really dirty and yucky, and look at the worms. But now it's so successful that the school are saying, well, thanks very much, I think we can maybe do this now. So that group are now looking for another area to develop. And we need, we being the collegiate, we of Public Scotland and wider, actually, because business plays a big role in this as well, look at what more we can do to enable that. One of the big opportunities, I think, is the Good Food Nation, which I think gives us the opportunity to tie together a number of strands that we have. I was at a conference last week organised by SURF, looking at regeneration, but specifically looking at community growing as part of regeneration across Scotland. And it was a really good conference. It had a combination of people from the kind of standard regeneration groups across Scotland, but also a range of people who were involved in all sorts of different models for community growing. And we need to share the energy that was in that room more. For our part, in the Scottish Government, as well as supporting, you know, a lot of those organisations, whether it from regeneration grants or from other empowerment grants, there is the specific aspects of the Act in relation to allotments and waiting lists. So the government has surveyed local authorities to try and identify the work that's ongoing. Obviously, this is a responsibility of local authorities rather than one of Scottish Government, but we were keen to work with COSLA and our local government partners to see if there's more we can do, particularly in light of the Good Food Nation Bill. So we now have contact points for allotment services across Scotland, and we're working with authorities to share good practice. I touched base with Councillor Gail McGregor, who's the COSLA lead, to suggest that we might consider how we can better support local authorities across Scotland. What we need to be careful of is that we're not causing an additional layer of bureaucracy in terms of reporting, but we're keen to work with local government partners to see whether there is a way of bringing commonality to the reporting that local authorities already do in order to make it easier for committees like yourselves and others to have that transparency of what's happening across Scotland. But for sure, there's a huge amount of work going on and a huge amount of progress happening right across Scotland, particularly in that community growing forum, where previously the only option for growing your own food was to have an allotment, which is really challenging for many, many people. It uses a substantial amount of land for per person, whereas community growing can potentially help reduce those waiting lists by giving people a more appropriate access for some people. So I think this is a really exciting time in this field, particularly with the opportunities that the Good Food Nation Plan brings for us.
OK, no, thanks for that. And just I recognise in my own constituency in Rakaise, we're seeing a great project, Scottish Government funding part, to implement allotments working alongside the pantry network. So it's a very effective project. And I recognise your comments on community growing, but I think government taking recognition also of these frustrations that are being expressed by these groups on allotments, I think, is very valuable, because there's some straightforward, simple things in there that could probably be implemented around about data and definitions and waiting list management and so on, that could be really help address many of those frustrations.
And we are obviously working with partners, and one of the groups to help us do that is the tripartite group. So that's Scottish Government working with local authorities and the Scottish Allotments and Gardens Society, SAGS, working together. To be fair, there's been a slowing down of the work there because of the work that we're doing on Good Food Nation. And you know, it tends to be the same people that are doing the same work, and Good Food Nation has been prioritised. I don't necessarily think that's a bad thing, but you're right, there are probably some easy gains that we need to do, but we need to do that in partnership rather than telling colleagues.
Thank you.
Thanks very much. Polycrubs is what you were looking for in terms of the windproof polytunnel. It's called a polycrub. And they are popping up all across my region. I wanted to bring Councillor Heddle in on that question. I thought you would like to give you opportunity if you have anything to say.
I can declare another interest in that. I have a local authority provided allotment, and the cultivation of this 100 square metres of weed-bearing soil just fills me full admiration for farmers. But I waited a few years before I managed to get this, and it's been a source of both frustration and joy for me. So I absolutely support the expansion of allotment provision. I think it's a powerful force for well-being, and it's also has clearly a role in it's a source of food supply. I think in terms of council's ability to support this area of well-being, sadly, it's limited by the challenging financial constraints facing local government. I wonder to what extent it plays into the wider community well-being role, to what extent the planning can take a role in this, in that the perhaps mandatory green spaces could become mandatory brown spaces in terms of new planning developments. But I also note the development of the community gardens and the polycrubs, as you mentioned. Our local health board has developed a polycrub on the site of the new hospital. And, I think this is a very positive development for everybody who has a chance to interact with it. So general support would be my own personal perspective. I know it also, however, sort of Costa didn't provide any evidence to the costless inquiry on allotments, so I won't purport to represent all of our member councils.
Thanks very much for that. And it's great to hear, Mr. Fitzpatrick, all of your experience, and the Dunoon story is tremendous. I could declare an interest that when I lived in New York City, I used to be majorly involved in community gardens there. But I think one of the things that I notice is we've got this direction of travel in the Community Empowerment Act around allotments, and the frustration that Ivan McKee is kind of raising, and our desire for that to be paid attention to. And something that's been brought to my attention recently is an allotment community garden project that has been told by a local authority that they are now going to have to pay the full ground rent on common good land that's going to be £13,000 a year. And that can't be paid out of their charity, their fundraising charity money. So there seems to be a bit of I think there's more work that needs to be done in terms of really allowing or supporting that community empowerment agenda, particularly part 9 of the Act, to kind of flow through to the most local level. And I totally understand that local authorities are potentially having to take those difficult decisions because it is a very difficult time in terms of local authority funding and finance. But it is just, you know, how do we start to recognise where we're all going together? And I think it's really fantastic that you're highlighting, Mr. Fitzpatrick, the Good Food Nation plan, and local authorities will be coming up with their plans, and hopefully they will work synergistically with the local food strategy plans that have had to come out of the Community Empowerment Act. So I think there's still some more work for all of us to be doing in terms of highlighting the importance and the enthusiasm that is coming from communities to seek the opportunity to have their own resilience and access to locally grown food and all of the benefits and the value co-benefits that come from that. I'm going to move on to something, a slightly different topic, and I'm going to bring in Mark Griffin.
Yeah. Thanks, Commissioner. Good morning. I've got a few questions just around the Powers in the Act relating to participation requests and asset transfers, and just kick off by asking if you think those two instruments around asset transfers and participation requests have helped to empower communities?
Yes, I do. I think they have played and they continue to play an important role. And I think it's important to recognise that they operate within a broader context of rights. They are just two particular mechanisms that are at the disposal. But we have seen, since these respective powers came into force, I think some 79 participation requests and over 200 asset transfer requests, with many more having also subsequently been made. So I think they're playing an important part within the ecosystem of community empowerment, and I think they are important tools as well and enhancing a more participatory approach to our democratic culture, and indeed as a key lever and enabler of not just regeneration but of community wealth building as well, specifically on the asset transfer request.
Talked about the numbers of applications for both asset transfer and participation request, and the participation request being a good bit lower than asset transfer. Does the government have an opinion as to why that might be, and whether you would consider there's any more work needs to be done to improve awareness and encourage communities to go down that particular route?
On that latter point, yes, we obviously see something that has been considered through the work being undertaken in the Community Empowerment Act review. I think what we've seen with participation requests is a development and evolution. I think from the outset, to some extent, we were predominantly still coming from community councils. But the subject of the participation request, the relevant PSA, is no longer just exclusively local government. We're seeing a wider range of partners. And they are being used to allow communities to engage in a range of different decision-making around roads and other local assets, for example. But what we have to do is to have a more detailed understanding of the landscape, and that is work that has been undertaken through the Community Empowerment Act review, and that information should become available as we move towards the completion of the review in the early part of next year. So I think there's learning to be undertaken from the experience to date. Previous consideration has demonstrated that the legislation was working as intended, but we recognise that there may be some opportunities for further development. One particular issue that has been raised before is the absence of an appeals or review mechanism. So that is something, again, we'll give further consideration to. I'm sure we'll be looking forward to engaging with the committee at the completion of the Community Empowerment Act review to explore what the findings of that have been. So that's specific with participation requests. With the asset transfers, I think we're seeing that grow and more, and it is, of course, as I say, it is one of a number of tools that are available. But as I look towards the introduction of legislation later in this parliamentary session on community wealth building, I think one of the key tools and enablers that has helped us to make progress in a way consistent with community wealth building aims, has been asset transfer requests, one of many admittedly, but I think it's been an important one. I think that's going to have a pivotal role to play. So that is something, again, as it's reviewed through the Community Empowerment Act, will inform what, if any, further steps we have to take in partnership with our local government partners and other public bodies to consider what ways we can enhance it and what further support is required.
That's good to hear. The previous version of the committee in the last session flagged the issue around the lack of appeals process for participation requests, so it's good to hear the government are considering that. And similarly, the predecessor committee also raised concerns about the asset transfer process potentially being overly bureaucratic, cumbersome and difficult sometimes for local organisations to navigate, particularly the examples that we've heard around the opportunities for community groups to take on areas of ground for allotment. So has the government done any work on the process around asset transfer, how to make it easier and more accessible for community groups who have that aspiration to take on a particular piece of land or asset that's held by a public authority?
There's two aspects. Of course, there's authority and there's a community group wishing to take the asset on. With regards to supporting community groups, we have provided funding to the Community Ownership Support Service, who provide expert support and guidance to organisations taking on or seeking to take on an asset. More broadly, there was the establishment of the National Asset Transfer Group, which has been working, I think, is helping as well to try and address these issues around consistency and sharing best practice. I don't know, perhaps, Kathleen, if you want to speak to some of the work that's been undertaken in that forum.
Yes, we've been working with a group of experts, and we've looked at various parts of the asset transfer pieces of legislation, and a particular piece of work we're doing with them now is on the review. We'll be working closely with them at picking on each part of the Act to see if it's fit for purpose or if any changes are needed to be made.
So, and Councillor Heddle, do you have any points to make in relation to the effectiveness of the participation requests or asset transfer powers in the legislation?
Yeah, yes, thanks. I mean, firstly, I'd like to obviously welcome that the community bodies have the opportunity to make participation requests and indeed to request asset transfers. I think these are both useful tools in the way that the community can engage with local authorities and public authorities to influence and shape the public services. But I suppose I'd note that the participation requests particularly are only one of a range of ways in which communities can want to get involved in services, because there's participatory budgeting. I'm delighted to trumpet that local government has met the target in respect of that. Local access panels and community consultation on council plans, etc. On the specific point of an appeals process for participation requests, I mean, COSLA doesn't currently have a mandate from our members to introduce an appeals process. So if one was required, would need to consider carefully with our members the best way for this to be supported, given the resource implications and the work that's already in place to ensure community participation. The point was made around the perhaps lower uptake participation requests compared to asset transfers, and I mean this is possibly due to higher levels of awareness of the asset transfers, in which case we can do more to raise awareness through participation requests through the various fora at our disposal, and you know it's also probably more due to the more tangible and finite nature of asset transfers. Certainly, we're aware that there's a number of good examples in ways in which groups are being supported to take ownership directly of the asset, or not to take ownership directly of the asset, but to take over the management of them. And I think I've made in this forum in the past the point that some groups prefer simply to manage the asset rather than take on the liabilities and maintenance, and leave that with the local authorities, which will have mixed views on this. But, you know, I currently support on this mode of operation as well.
Thank you.
Very much. We're now going to move on to questions from Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to you. I wanted to ask about two aspects of the Act that have not yet been brought into force. As you know, the Act came into force in 2015. It's now 8 years on. But Part 7 of the Act is intended to facilitate supporter engagement in football clubs. And Part 10 is to enable ministers to require public authorities to help the public to participate in the decision-making process. So it was just to get your views on these aspects and whether you'll bring these provisions into force anytime soon.
Well, on the on Part 10, I would first of all situate this in the context of the review and not want to presuppose any outcomes, and indeed the wider democracy matters. I refer, and I appreciate I referred to that several times, but I would recognise that where we might operate in government with distinct reviews, people will bring forward ideas as and when they see fit. With regards to the Part 10 on requirements, it's not something that has, of course, been introduced, and it's not something that we certainly have any plans at this stage to take forward. Of course, I think any move to introduce that mechanism or some similar mechanism would require very detailed consideration and very close engagement and a clear rationale for it. But I actually think what we've seen in recent years is not just a significant improvements in the ability of communities to engage and to participate in decision-making and to take on assets, through statutory means, but also through non-statutory means. And Councillor Heddo touched upon participatory budgeting, and you know, let me again, to the deal in the summer, commend and congratulate COSLA on achieving that 1% target. So participatory budgeting is an example where there has been an opportunity for communities to have much more say in how resources are allocated in their particular area. I think one of the things that's been very encouraging around participatory budgeting is, notwithstanding the benefits it confers, but moving away from just discrete pots of money specifically allocated to authorities challenging themselves and how communities can have more say over existing budgets. So, for example, on budgets around roads and maintenance and the environment. And we've seen some really excellent examples of that. I would have to go and commend the work of one of the local authorities in my own constituency, Renfrewshire Council, and what they have achieved there as well. So I think we're actually, with regards to the overall culture around community empowerment, notwithstanding what has been achieved through the statutory mechanisms, we're seeing non-statutory mechanisms as well taking place. And I think through the work of the local governance review and working in partnership under the provisions and the spirit of the Verity House Agreement, I think we'll achieve much more by trying to, you know, change culture, change practice, than necessarily having to have more statutory mechanisms. But I don't want to, you know, preclude the outcome of the review, and I would only want to reiterate that any decisions that are arrived at will be done so in a spirit of partnership consistent with Verity House.
Thanks very much for that, Tom. That's a good response. Before we come to the football issue, perhaps if Joe's addressing that, Councillor Heddo, what's your view on this? Is it effectively, are we effectively saying that the purpose behind that intention is in effect and working well? Because I'm certainly aware of the participatory budget and successes here, there and everywhere in Scotland, particularly in East Ayrshire as well. So are we saying that we don't think we need to bring it into force? There's good enough practice taking place to... that means we don't need to bring that into effect. Councillor Heddo.
Yes, I'm sorry. I thought your question was specifically around the football clubs. Can you clarify what you're particularly asking me about here?
There was two parts, Councillor Herald. Part 7 is about football club supporter engagement, but part 10, which hasn't been brought into effect yet, is to require ministers to enable public participation in the decision-making process. And the Minister was setting out there some really good examples across Scotland where it's kind of happening anyway without having to bring this piece of the legislation into effect. And I wonder if that was your shared experience too.
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, I think a requirement is perhaps a sledgehammer to crack. Not I'm suggesting that community participation is a not. It's community participation is extremely important. And I think that the all spheres of government would be extremely unwise not to wish to do this as a matter of course in all the business that we do. So, I mean, my own belief would be it's not necessary to enact that.
OK, thanks for that, Councillor Herald. Joe, could I turn to yourself perhaps to answer the part 7 on the supporters' engagement in football clubs?
Yeah, so obviously part 7 gives ministers power to make regulations to facilitate supporter involvement and give fans rights in a number of areas. So the Scottish Government held a consultation in 2016 on that, and there's been no action taken since. So I think this would sit within the portfolio of the Minister for Sport. So I think if colleagues are OK, I would maybe ask the Minister for Sport to just write giving an update on where government's views are in light of the responses to that consultation back in 2016.
Finally, though, just to ask you about when will the government conclude its overall review of the Act, and how soon do you foresee that being published and so on?
And it would be in the first half of next year. That is the aspiration, and as I indicated earlier, I'd be more than happy to appear before the committee to discuss the outcome of that and next steps once it's published.
Okay. Many thanks, everybody. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Willie. A few times you've mentioned, and I'm going to direct this question to Councillor Pedlock because I think he mentioned it more times than anybody else this morning. Democracy Matters Part 2. I think we'd be interested to hear a little bit about what your thinking is in what that process is going to be. We are familiar with the Part 1, and we took evidence, I think, around that as part of other processes we were doing. But it'd be just interesting for us to hear that, you know, what are you going to be doing in terms of engagement and the kind of time frame of that?
Chair, with your indulgence, I'd like to bring in my colleague, Mr. Smythe, on this. He will be closer to the timelines.
Thanks.
Good morning, Convener. The launch took place on Monday. In terms of specific activity that COSRA will be involved in, I mean, we'll be doing our best to promote awareness of this, but in terms of specific actions around this, I think we've yet to sort of thrash out how we can ensure the work is as effective as possible and engages and secures as many and wider range of views on future models across Scottish communities. So for the time being, I think I'd leave it at that.
Thanks very much. Mr. Arthur, you'd like to come in.
Anticipating it, this will run for about 6 months, so take us to February. So roughly concluding, the approximate timescales for the Review of the Community Empowerment Act. We're asked, working with partners, to facilitate a range of engagements that will take place across Scotland. We're published materials as well, so there's a number of pieces of work that are taking place to facilitate that activity. And if it would be helpful or useful to the committee, I'd be happy to provide maybe a written update towards the end of the year, beginning of next year, just on the progress that's been made today. And of course, at the conclusion, more than happy to appear before the committee to discuss further.
Thank you very much. Well, yes, you're certainly lining up some more work for yourself in terms of coming to see us. But I just wanted to say thank you so much for everyone joining us this morning and, you know, helping us understand your perspectives on community empowerment and the direction of travel for this community empowerment agenda that we have in Scotland. And I'm now going to briefly suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of officials. Thank you. We now turn to agenda item 4, which is to take evidence on the new deal with local government, which was agreed between the Scottish Government and COSLA and published in June. And we're joined once again for this item by Joe Fitzpatrick, who's the Minister for Local Government, Empowerment and Planning. And the Minister is supported for this item by Ellen Lever, who's the Deputy Director of Local Government and Analytical Services Division at the Scottish Government. And Councillor Heddle is also joining us again for this session, and this time is supported by Sarah Waters, who's the Director of Membership and Resources at COSLA. Both of our witnesses intend to make short opening statements, and I will invite Mr. Fitzpatrick to do so first, followed by Councillor Heddle, and I will then open questions from members. Mr. Fitzpatrick.
Thank you, Convener, and I want to thank the committee for the opportunity to give some brief opening remarks. We collectively recognise that the two spheres of government play a vital role in delivering sustainable public services that our communities rely upon across Scotland. Building, maintaining and valuing a strong working relationship with local government is therefore a key priority for this government. As the committee will be aware, the need for a reset of the relationship between local and national government was first set out in the resource spending review last year. The First Minister reiterated the commitment to a new deal with local government in his policy prospectus, A Fresh Start for Scotland, in April, and again on the 30th of June when he, the Deputy First Minister and myself, signed a partnership agreement to be known as the Verity House Agreement alongside the COSLA presidential team and political group leaders. I believe that the Verity House Agreement will better enable both spheres of government to work effectively together to achieve improved outcomes for communities across Scotland. However, the agreement only marks the beginning of the new deal with local government. COSLA and the Scottish Government are working jointly at pace on a new fiscal framework and shared work programme, including an outcomes and accountability framework to underpin the Verity House Agreement. Taken together, these should balance greater flexibility over local financial arrangements with clearer accountability, whilst demonstrating strong delivery of better outcomes for people and communities. If we can get this new deal right, I believe it will make a positive difference to our communities and the lives of the people that we serve. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Councillor Heddle?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I would like to echo the Minister's remarks and add that I acknowledge that we're in the early days of the Verity House Agreement. So we very much anticipate ongoing discussions with the committee as the agreement matures and becomes the default mode of operation. The agreement will set the tone for positive joint working on a range of key areas, including the community planning agenda, which we've just discussed, and where we need to work together to ensure that local community planning partnerships are able to maximise the role it can play in strengthening local democracy in acting on decisions made locally, in the way that you highlighted yourself in the previous session. Signing the Verity House Agreement at the end of June marks a positive step in terms of our shared task to reset the relationship between local and national government, in which the Minister has just mentioned. And as we make progress, I too believe that the agreement will enable us to secure one of COSLA's key priorities, which is a renewed relationship with the Scottish Government based on trust and mutual respect. And having said that, I'm encouraged by the impact the agreement has already had on working relationships even before it was signed. We've recently held a number of engagements involving officials from both spheres of government, and I think this momentum is set to continue in the future. In addition, as Mr. Fitzpatrick said, the agreement marks only the beginning, and it's just one element of a new deal, but I do sense a fresh optimism and willingness across politicians and officials alike to make the most of this opportunity. So I'm looking forward to seeing communities across Scotland reaping the rewards, which I think will come from our spheres of government working together to secure all the empowerments that we want to see devolved to the local level. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And I'm just really heartened to hear the progress that has been made since we were all together in May in Edinburgh on the session that the committee held around the New Deal. And it's, so it's great to see that things are moving along swiftly, and we will, you know, we're kind of passionate about keeping an eye on this. Obviously, local government is in our title, so it's important for us to support the process as much as possible. The New Deal highlights three shared priorities for the government and COSLA: tackling poverty, a just transition to net zero, and sustainable public services, and notes that there will be a focus on achieving better outcomes. And I'd be interested to hear from you both what kind of discussions you've had around how you achieve those outcomes, but also how those priorities were identified and agreed. And Mr. Fitzpatrick.
Yeah, so, I mean, I think it would be good if Sarah and Ellen are able to contribute to this section, because they've been very much involved in the actual day-to-day work around this. But I think if we look to the three shared priorities, and look back to the resource spending review, these roughly align with the priorities from that. But I think, obviously, coming from there, there was a degree of work which Sarah and Ellen will have been involved in to look at that and then take that back to politicians. But I think it's almost like there wasn't a particular argument around those three priorities that they make sense. And I think the value of that is shown by the fact that Verity House agreement with those three priorities was not only able to be supported by the Scottish Government and the COSLA presidential leader, but by the political leaders across the COSLA organisation, so all parties were able to sign up to that. And I guess that's the strength of having looked at some top-level outcomes and, you know, what difference are we trying to make. And actually, on many of these things, whatever our political perspective is, and we might have differences about how we get there, we share a common desire to improve the lives of people in Scotland, and those three priorities help us with that.
Thanks very much. Councillor Heddle, do you have anything to add?
In terms of the identification of the priorities, Mr. Fitzpatrick explained, essentially where they came from. And indeed, they also chimed very well with the priorities that we have articulated in our own council COSLA plan. I mean, if you look at them, they're so fundamental that it would be difficult to argue with them, and there's so many good things will flow from them should we be successful in tackling these three on the face of it fairly simply expressed ambitions, but, you know, absolutely fundamental to the whole well-being and future of this country. So I think we haven't really had any disagreement over the priorities. It's been pretty much from the start, it's been agreed that yes, these are the fundamental things that we need to work on, both in terms of the tackling poverty to eliminate inequality, recognising the existential threat of the climate crisis, and the need to be able to provide the services that matter so much to our communities.
Thanks very much. And yes, thanks for underscoring the fact that those are kind of, it's difficult to argue against those three priorities. Absolutely. I just wondered, Mr. Fitzpatrick, you suggested that maybe Ellen and Sarah might want to come in on a bit more detail. So, Ellen, I'll start with you. I just want to say that one of my challenges around facilitating is that they tend to go to the people in the room. So I'm mindful about going to people online, but Ellen, I'll go with you first and then Sarah can come to you.
Thank you, Convener. No, I would absolutely echo what the Minister and Councillor Heddle have said. There wasn't ever any sense of disagreement. They were very naturally come to as three priorities in reflecting first on the resource spending review and that commitment to a reset, but the wider context of the resource spending review, and through a number of discussions, both amongst officials and amongst ministers and politicians through the multiple governance that we have in place to support that relationship over the past 12 months and more since the resource spending review, it's really been about how we go about that relationship that we've had, the discussion being focused on. The sense of coalescing around these three priorities came very early and fairly easy to providing that focus point.
That sounds like a very constructive process. Sarah, do you have anything to add?
Yeah, mention the COVID recovery strategy. So that was something that both spheres of government jointly signed up to. So the three priorities there were financial security for low-income households, well-being of children and young people, and good green jobs and fair work. And I think threaded through that COVID recovery strategy was that person-centred service focus. So again, that was combined with the resource spending review, they just seemed the kind of natural place to go. Reform is never far away from all agendas, given resource constraints and demand pressures. So just to echo what colleagues have said, but those were the kind of key areas where these priorities flowed from.
Thanks very much for that, and thanks for reminding us about the COVID recovery strategy. I think that is an important piece of the background there. I'd like to move on, and I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey with questions.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning again, Joe. You and I, Joe, are probably the two members around this table that were around during the historic Concordat in 2007. And as you will recall, that was very much based on connecting itself with structures within the national performance framework. But the New Deal doesn't connect it to the National Performance Framework, but I think you mentioned an outcomes framework. So could you give us a little bit of an insight in how that will be achieved and how we'll measure progress and outcomes this time round?
So MPF hasn't been... MPF is still there, that still exists, but it's probably useful at this point then to recognise that the New Deal is not just the Verity House Agreement, and I think that's really important because I think sometimes these are being used almost as if it's the same thing. Verity House Agreement is part of the New Deal with local government. It's the partnership agreement. Underneath that, there are three other aspects, and one of them is I think really important to what we're talking about here. So the second area is the fiscal framework. Third area is the completion of the local governance review, which we've talked about in the last session. And the kind of final strand is the joint work programme with an outcomes and accountability framework. And I think that is really, really important. I think that's the big difference between the Verity House Agreement and the Concordat. And the Concordat served a really important purpose, and it was transformational at the time. I think for the New Deal with local government, we are obviously learning from some of the challenges that over time the lack of an outcomes and accountability framework meant that, let's be honest, we reverted to old ways, and ring fencing increased as the easy way of ticking a box, effectively easier way of getting accountability to this committee sometimes, I guess. So it's really important that we get that outcomes and accountability framework right. That's not something we can do overnight, but the Verity House Agreement gives us a set of agreed ways forward, ways of working to achieve an outcomes and accountability framework, which hopefully will stand us in good stead for well into the future.
I certainly recognise what you've said there, Joe, but this time round, do you think all of the council, the participant councils in COSLAT, are they signed up to the New Deal? Because that was kind of the issue before, that not all of the councils carried it through, let's say, and that led to more of a reliance on ring fencing, which none of us want these days. So are you getting a broad sense that there's agreement amongst the participating councils?
So I've met with all of the leaders of all of Scotland's local authorities, and obviously as part of that, the leaders of each of the political groups. And I think the appetite is absolutely clear that I think folks see the real opportunity here to get that reset, not just for this year, not just for next year, but for the long term, to really reset the way that the Scottish Government and local government work together to the benefit of our communities. And so yes, the appetite for this changes, I think across the parties, maybe in a way that wasn't. And maybe that's partly to the fact that there's maybe a little bit less flag waving than maybe the Concordat was flagged up. It's clear that we're on a journey and there's a lot of work for us to do. So the Verity House Agreement was a really important part of that process, really important partnership agreement. But it's in no way concludes the New Deal with local government, it's a starting point. It's about how we're going to work together, respecting both of our democratic mandates.
Thank you, Joe. I'd really appreciate if Councillor Heddle had a view on this. What makes it likely this time round, Councillor Heddle, that this will be perhaps more successful than the previous Concordat was in 2007?
Well, I think the previous Concordat was something that was welcomed by councils at the time. I too was around at that time, just a new councillor in 2007. And the kind of fundamental principles of the Concordat, I think, in terms of respect and the local governments, need to be able to take the totality of the resource and apply it to a subset or a smaller set of clearly defined outcomes. It's not dissimilar to what is being spoken about here. I think, obviously, the Verity Hills Agreement goes further, as Mr Fitzpatrick says. There's more to it. There's more to the New Deal than just the Verity Hills Agreement. And the previous Concordat lacked was the monitoring and accountability framework, which is proposed here. I mean, you made a very good point in terms of how this relates to the National Performance Framework. Clearly, local government and Scottish Government are co-signatories to the National Performance Framework. And I think in the spirit of proportionate reporting, we'll be wanting to see where National Performance Framework indicators, or indeed local government benchmarking framework indicators, the ones that we have already in place, will map or can be amended to fit the monitoring and accountability framework that we must develop. In terms of the buy-in, certainly at our leaders' meetings, we've had unanimous support for the Verity Hills Agreement. And we've also had all our group leaders co-signing it back at the end of May. So I think we all recognise how good this can be for our communities if we can make it work. So I think the buy-in at this stage is good, though of course can never be taken for granted. I mean, we anticipate that there will be areas on which we will disagree, perhaps within local government or between local government and Scottish Government, then we need to resolve that in the kind of respectful and understood manner that's outlined in the Verity Hills Agreement itself.
OK. Thank you both very much. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks for that. Thanks, Willie. I think Sarah indicated that she wanted to come in.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I was just to reiterate Council Heddle's point, there was not a month went by in the first half of 2023 where we didn't speak with our group leaders, political group leaders, about this through our leadership sounding board. So at every month, we were discussing the kind of tone and content of the Verity House agreement. So very much focused on how we would develop jointly the way we were going to work together. So I think to get to the 30th of June, we did, as Councillor Heddle said, get the buy-in from the group leaders who eventually went on to sign the agreement, which was I think was no mean feat. We're now in the period of working jointly with Scottish Government around the development of what we're going to do, and likewise we're involving our professional associations from across Scottish councils, so we'll very much continue in that vein, which is really positive.
Thanks very much. I'm now going to bring in Pam Gosol.
Thank you, Chair. In the past, considerable amounts of local government budgets have been ring-fenced to deliver on Scottish Government's priorities. So if councils have that independence, what assurances exist that such a move will have a positive impact on the delivery of shared priorities and outcomes? And what mechanisms are in place to ensure that the Scottish Government does not regress from this independence?
So that's a really important question, and that's why we're not coming with the Verity House Agreement. It wasn't a here's it all completed. There is a lot of work to do to get that right, to get that right in a respectful way, working together, COSLA and the Scottish Government. And that work, Sarah mentioned, is ongoing now to get that outcome framework correct. Obviously, part of the work that's already ongoing as well is around the fiscal framework to identify a better way of taking that forward, looking at where we can have different arrangements in order to agree our shared outcomes.
Very much. And I think a little bit kind of deepening in that, what role is there of this? What role of the Scottish Government, what would the role of the Scottish Government be if a local authority is failing to make progress on shared priorities, or if services in key developed areas such as education or social care are perceived to be underperforming? Have you gotten that far in the agreement work that you're doing?
So I think we need to respect our different democratic mandates. So that's the kind of starting point. So this can't ever feel to local government like Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament coming in to check their schoolwork, check their homework, and work in that way. But I think what's really important as part of the outcome framework is transparency. So increasing transparency in a way that works for all of us, so we're not talking about over-reporting, but making sure that transparency is there, and that makes sure that in Scottish Government and also accountable, making sure there's clear lines of accountability, who's accountable for what part of decision-making, and that allows our electors to challenge us, and it allows local government's electorate to challenge them. And I think if we get that right, then so I think it's really important that we do get that right. And that will take time. And that's some of the work that's ongoing.
Thanks very much. Councillor Heddle, do you want to follow up on anything there?
Yeah, I mean, this is related to Mr Coffey's question about the accountability framework. I mean, clearly, we've made the point, which has been accepted by the Verity House Agreement, that from this point onwards, the default position will be no ring fencing or direction funding unless there's a clear joint understanding for our rationale for such. And that is on the basis that we feel if we have the flexibility to allocate our limited funding within our local authority areas and across our services, we can achieve the best value and the best balance of outcomes for our community, and in terms of the shared ambitions that we have with the Scottish Government. Mr Fitzpatrick made the very good point that we're not solely accountable to the Scottish Government or this committee or the Accounts Commission or Audit Scotland. We're also accountable to our own electorate, and they very much will hold us to account to deliver the services as best we can. And if we're not delivering the services that we should expect, we need to explain why and how, and hope that there's a degree of understanding. I mean, clearly, in terms of some of the areas that's been highlighted, you're speaking about marking our homework. We have regular education inspections, where social services are inspected by the care inspectorate. So there are mechanisms in place, along with Audit Scotland, along with the Accounts Commission, that keep an eye on local government and how we're delivering our services. But the key thing in this is going to be the accountability framework and outcomes framework that we're speaking about in the previous question. And we need to be able to get that right, because the quid pro quo obviously is for having the presumption of local by default, national by agreement, no ring fencing, is that it'll lead to an improvement in services rather than a diminution in services. But they need to be looked in the totality of the services that we provide.
Thanks very much for that. And Minister, you indicated you want to come back in.
Actually, Councillor Heddle made the point I had forgot to make about independent scrutiny and the kind of range of bodies which have that role as well.
Great. That's why you're, teamwork, right? It's great. Pam, you wanted to come back in.
Thank you, Chair. Under the new Verity House Agreement, there will be more flexibility for councils to spend as they see fit. We've spoken about that, which we've heard today, that it's very welcomed and it sounds great. But my question is around where the accountability will lie. And recently, we all know that it's revealed that councils are expected to make cuts around £300 million. And if, for example, a council makes a decision to access from the education budget and then attainment begins to fall, who is accountable for that? And is it the Scottish Government who left councils no choice but to make these cuts? Or is it the council's responsibility for taking the money out of the education budget? So, first of all, obviously, the Minister, yeah.
So, I think it's really important that we do develop clear lines of accountability, who's accountable for what, and that's part of the work that we're doing. I think just in terms of some of the backside to the question there around local government finance, I think it's appropriate to recognise the challenges that all public services are facing in the current times, with the massive inflation, let alone just the energy inflation, and the challenges that is facing on all aspects of public service. But I guess just to respond to the point, we do have the Accounts Commission's report, which is clear that we have increased local government funding over years. That doesn't take away the challenges that local government are facing just now by any means. But I think it's appropriate that we have a mature conversation, a transparent conversation, so we can show who's accountable, how the money's been spent, and what the outcomes are being achieved, and what the lines of accountability are where those outcomes are not being achieved. That will be really important that we get that right in that accountability framework.
Could I ask Councillor Hegel about this as well, please?
Yeah, thanks. I don't want to spoil the teamwork, but I think the Accounts Commission also noted that in real terms, local government's funding had decreased over the years, which is clearly a problem for us. In terms of the accountability, the various functions and services are devolved to local government, so the accountability lies with us in the first instance, and in respect of these services. And so I think it's important to acknowledge that, that we have to represent our communities why things are how they are and the reasons for that. And if we don't have a good explanation for it, clearly they will hold us to account. The point that I think we've made in the past is that there's a risk in the Scottish Government feeling that they have the ownership of all problems, including our own, means that they feel that they must address these problems directly, which leads to the ring fencing and directional budgets, which from our perspective leads to a situation where we have to rob Peter to pay Paul. And the oft-cited example, if you want to know what sort of ring fencing and direction of spend means, look at the condition of your roads, because that's the areas, one of the areas that's not protected and has to take the brunt of the cuts. So I freely admit that I think local government will find itself more accountable, but appropriately accountable for the services it provides as part of this.
Thank you.
Thanks, Pam. And kind of continuing on that theme, and I recognise that you're in a process of kind of co-design in a way on some of these aspects that you've outlined, but I'd be interested to hear, and I'll start with you, Councillor Heddle. You've talked about local by default, national by agreement, but I'd be interested to understand what mechanisms would be put in place if you've had that kind of discussion to resolve any kind of disagreements, whether either national or local government, you know, where there's a disagreement that you might have about the rationale for a national approach. Have you kind of explored that yet? You got those mechanisms in place?
We have to recognise that this is early days of the agreement, and it's a work in progress, and there's lots of things that they require to be completely bottomed out. But I think if you refer to the agreement, we set out how we should carry these things forward in the first section, the way we work together, but starting off the position of mutual trust and respect, and recognising that if we do disagree on issues, that we'll deal with the matters constructively in the spirit of cooperation and through the engagement mechanisms described in Section D of the agreement, which is the various forms of dialogue that's to take place primarily between the First Minister and the Coastal President, but also through our the Leadership Sounding Board and groups of cabinet members. This is also augmented by the almost continual dialogue that I can see happening already between our respective officers, and Sarah might want to come in on that. But I think the positive thing that I want to emphasise here is that our dialogue is already so much better, and that the kind of prospect of being able to resolve things in a informed and mutually respectful way is greatly enhanced.
That's great to hear, that the dialogue is much improved. Minister, would you like to come in on anything there?
There's not much to add. I think having that spirit of partnership at the centre of all of our interactions is actually crucial. And clearly there will need to be a mechanism for how we take forward disagreement. But if we have that spirit of partnership as our starting point, then hopefully those disagreements will be the exception rather than the rule. So I think that's...
OK, thanks. Anybody else want to come in? Ellen?
I think the only thing I would add to what you said is a lot of those engagement mechanisms are building on what's already in place and has been working well, either over a period of time or which we've established as part of the process of negotiating the Verity House Agreement. And we've decided that that's a relevant mechanism to continue and to embed into the agreement. And that's particularly the case in relation to the joint meeting between the Leadership Signing Board and senior cabinet ministers, to which Councillor Heddle referred. That was a key part of the process for the Verity House Agreement, and something we think would merit continuing.
Thanks very much for that. I'm going to move on. I'm going to bring in Marie McNair.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, the new deal states that local government settlement will be simplified and consolidated. Can you expand on how you're progressing towards a settlement and what benefits this approach will deliver?
So there's a fair bit of work already taken place to develop the fiscal framework. Part of that work is looking at all the areas of ring fencing and direction, and looking to see where opportunities can be to relax that. Now, the starting point is that for going forward, we shouldn't have ring fencing, but there's obviously a fair degree of, well, it's actually about 7%, I think, of council funding is currently ring fenced, but it's fair, I think, in the spirit of partnership, to recognise that even when funds aren't ring-fenced, often there is a degree of direction. And if you speak to senior council officials, they will tell you that sometimes, even when there's no ring-fencing, it's the reporting that is overly burdensome. So if we can try and find mechanisms that give us that assurance in terms of outcomes, then we can remove some of that unnecessary bureaucracy going forward. So that is a work in progress, but a significant amount of progress has been made, and we're hoping to have made some progress for this year's budget.
Thanks, that would be very much welcome from councillors. Obviously, previously said, being a previous councillor, so I can have get it. We heard that some individual councils are unhappy with the current funding formula. Will the fiscal framework and related work address these concerns? And finally, also one of the stated priorities, as already mentioned, of the New Deal is tackling poverty. Some feel that currently funding formula doesn't give enough weight to recognising poverty and deprivation levels. Will this be something you consider going forward?
So these are matters which have to be taken forward in collaboration with our partners. It would be absolutely wrong and against the spirit of Verity House for the government to say we're going to change the funding formula unilaterally. So any changes around that have to be in partnership. I guess in terms of tackling poverty, by giving local authorities more flexibility around how they use their budgets, I would hope that many of them would choose to use that flexibility to target poverty. It's one of the three outcomes that we've agreed, so it's absolutely should be there. But I know that some local authorities, my own local authority in Dundee, took a decision to fund many of the anti-poverty measures beyond what would be statutory because of their particular circumstances in the city of Dundee. And I guess If we give local authorities more flexibility, then they will be able to make those choices which work for their areas. And you know, that is the principle of subsidiarity, those decisions being made at the correct level and respecting the democratic mandate that our local government colleagues have in their own right. But maybe Ellen might be able to say a little bit more about some of the works in terms of the work around the fiscal framework.
I'm happy to. I'm sure also that Councillor Heddle and Sarah will have a view on this. It's obviously for them to speak for the views of local government, but we have had long discussions about the fiscal framework and we're continuing to have those negotiations. Obviously, the questions about quantum are very key to that and how we come to that quantum, but distribution is an element of obviously how the local government settlement is delivered to councils. So it's something that is very relevant to the discussion, but those are very live negotiations. And I think the Minister has very succinctly put those questions about the purpose here being to empower local government to make those decisions locally and where we can get to, and the fiscal framework to make that as smooth and as transparent as possible is our ambition.
Thank you. Councillor Heddle.
Yes, thanks very much. I think in terms of the simplified and consolidated quantum that we have, there's two aspects to that. The consolidated, obviously, is the removal of the ring fencing and directed spend. And in local government, we feel that there's a lot of that, that we only have the ability to spend probably about 30% of our budgets. In terms of the aspect that's not ring fenced or directed. Sarah might be able to correct me on that figure, but that's my recollection of what it is. But the other thing is that by simplifying it, we should have a shared understanding of what it all means, because every year at present we have a post-budget bun fight where the figures are presented by the Scottish Government and by local government that are at odds in interpretation. And, you know, if we want to carry forward a mutually respectful relationship, we need to get away from that. So this is a key kind of aspect to that. Now, fundamentally, we can't get away from the fact that local government needs more money. If we're going to be able to carry forward all our aspirations, because we're struggling to provide all the services that we wish at present. And we've lost a significant chunk of our workforce since 2013. And, you know, it really is a struggle that I've been a councillor for 17 years, and it's as hard as it's ever been to come up with a budget that's just not going to devastate the services that we provide for our community. So fundamentally, we need more money. We can't get away from that. But however much money we get, the removal of ring fencing, the directed spend, is going to enable us to prioritise it most appropriately to the needs and aspirations of our community.
Thanks for that. Celia, would you like to make any further points before I hand back to the convener?
I mean, I think you'll know yourself, the local government settlement is extremely complicated, and I think it's made more complicated, not necessarily just by the ring fence funding, but by the in-year transfers that come from different portfolios. So part of the work that Ellen and I are trying to do is to consolidate some of that, so that it's not the annual kind of, oh, I wonder if that portfolio is going to transfer in that money or not. It actually is transferred in, because it provides the funding for a function that local government will carry out. I think in terms of the funding formula, that would very much be a decision that that leaders would have to take, because you know it would impact all councils. We, you know, there is, as Councillor Heddle says, an issue with the overall quantum, but what we don't want is local government kind of tearing itself apart in terms of the way that the money is distributed. And I think, as Councillor as Mr Fitzpatrick said, if councils see more flexibility with the way that they can use resources, hopefully that aids their budgeting as much as redistributing. But as we did back in, I think it was 2018, we did review the funding formula and looked at the funding floor. And at that point, professional advisors who advised leaders said that actually stability was extremely important. And I think, you know, with redistribution, you could get a real volatility there. And there was a second part of your question. I think it was Councillor Headland mentioned that the, you know, we do get into this kind of post-budget bun fight every year about ring fencing, etc. I think currently COSLA's position would be that around about 65% of our budget is really not able to be used for local priorities. It goes on things like teachers' pay, teachers' pensions, all the other things that councils have got to provide for. But what we're really working hard as part of the fiscal framework is actually getting that kind of common understanding of the challenges on both sides. Now, some of that challenge comes from Scottish Government having a top-line budget figure of, I think it was about $59.4 billion last year. But actually, not all of that is at the discretion of Scottish Government. There are things that come out of that that have to be factored in. So it's getting to the point with the budget engagement between Councillor Hagman and the DFM and Mr Arthur, where there's that common understanding on each side. And I think, you know, we've struggled to do that in the past, but we're really working hard to get to that position.
Thank you.
Thanks very much, Marie. And that's interesting to hear that level of detail and that common understanding that's being worked on. And I would imagine that part of our kind of the demonstration of success, maybe not necessarily this year because it's early days, but into the future, will be that we won't be having the bun fights because there's been so much co-design up front to lead into the budget discussions. Now going to bring in Ivan McKee.
Thanks, Convener. I'd like to turn to the area of public sector reform, and the New Deal talks about working constructively and quickly to remove barriers which hinder flexibility, with a focus on enabling innovation and whole system improvement. And clearly that gives an opportunity not just to improve service levels, but also, reflecting back on the previous question, to potentially find ways to do things more efficiently and effectively by taking down barriers, removing duplication between Scottish and local government. So I'd just like to explore that a wee bit further, what work's happening in that space, and if there's any examples of those kind of barriers or opportunities that have been identified, and the process to tackle and remove those.
I think I'm best passing over to Ellen, if that's OK.
Thank you very much for the question. There is a commitment to a shared approach to public service reform within the Verity House Agreement, and there are live discussions. I think Sarah has been more closely involved than I have. It's sitting with other colleagues, so I'm sure she could speak to it. But about having a joint programme looking at public service reform with local government, and what does that mean? And very much focused on that person-centred approach, which was so central to the COVID recovery strategy, learning from the range of Pathfinder and project approaches that have taken place across the country. And I think it's about building on that and looking at where we can scale up the learning from those Pathfinders, and where we can start to see that take place, build on that in local government, but also being very conscious within our decisions as the Scottish Government and in our public bodies landscape in relation to public service reform, about how that can impact a local government, thinking back to the earlier session as well about the role of those partners within community planning partnerships, so needing to see it very, very holistically. And I think, you know, Sarah will have more to say perhaps on the detail, but we'd be happy to take that back to colleagues and arrange for a letter to committee setting out more of the information about that programme.
Yeah, no, thanks for that. That sounds, to be honest, relatively top level, so it'd be good to get into some of the specifics where opportunities have been identified, quantified, and what work is happening to take it forward. Councillor Heddle, do you want to comment on that?
Ellen sat there beating me to the punch in mentioning the COVID recovery strategy as a kind of template for where we could go. I was just wanting to highlight the ongoing work that's been carried forward by the Community Planning Improvement Board on three main areas, which is climate change, financial security for low-income households, and the well-being of children and young people. So this is some work that's ongoing and being led by that, and I would hope would sort of feed into this aspect of the Verity House Agreement.
Okay, and Sarah, is there anything you want to comment on, any of the specifics here?
Yeah, I think a lot of what you're alluding to and suggesting that you'd like information is actually coming through the officer discussions that we're having. So we've held a number of workshops between senior Scottish Government deputy directors, etc., and COSLA staff and SOLIS and directors of finance. And a lot of the kind of barriers to reform have come up. So actually through the shared work programme, we're going to have to develop solutions to the things that are getting in the way of like data sharing, like accounting regulations, like funding flexibilities, etc. So we've got to work through these things. We actually wrote, COSLA wrote to the finance committee with much more detail on this, so we could perhaps share the letter with you. And one of the key concerns in the submission that we made to that committee was that there are going to be some key touch points between wider public service reform, i.e. the 129 odd bodies that are part of the Scottish Government's programme, and local government. Now, in the resource spending review, local government was invited to take a complementary approach to public service reform. Local government is doing a huge amount in that space, and as I say, that letter articulates some of that. But there's some touch points. If you think about, you know, two overlapping circles, there are things that police, fire, Skills Development Scotland, all the other bodies will do that will impact locally. And that brings us back to community planning as the key part, the key body or the key kind of driver of local resource decision making and working through some of those person-centred service challenges, because there could be decisions taken by national bodies about reform that actually make no sense locally on the ground when you get into a place and the delivery of services in that place. So we are working closely with Mary McCallan's team to make sure that we don't create kind of tensions between national programmes for public service reform and local approaches to person-centred services, because we've got to make sure that those touch points make sense and that that local government's fully involved, as is articulated in the Verity House Agreement.
No, I understand that, and I can see the importance of that. I suppose what I'm maybe not hearing that I may have expected to hear is that there's areas of duplication have been identified. Well, you did mention data sharing and the opportunities there and the ability to move data, common approaches to digital, overlaps between the work of different agencies, government and local government, where people are all in the same space trying to do the same thing. Because clearly in an era where there are cost challenges, identifying and freeing up resource from those areas has got to be a prize worth seeking. Okay.
Yes, so sorry if I could just add, local government is doing a huge amount in the area of shared services. I mean, even within COSLA, we have the Digital Office, we have Trade and Standards Scotland, we have Business Gateway, we have My Job Scotland. These are all services that are shared by local government across Scotland. And as I say, the letter that we sent to the FPAC goes into more detail on that.
OK, I look forward to seeing that. The other question I was going to ask is the situation with regards to UK government in this regard, because clearly we're increasingly seeing a situation where UK government is seeking to engage with local government through a variety of mechanisms. Is that something that has been considered within the discussion in the New Deal, or is it something that's kind of been left out of scope in terms of how that relationship potentially cuts across some of the work that you're doing?
Yeah, so the New Deal and the Verity House Agreement is an agreement between local government and the Scottish Government. So I guess that's. But these are all factors that we need to be alert to as we move forward.
Okay. So that elephant in the room is being considered?
Well, the agreement is an agreement between the Scottish Government and local government.
Okay. But, thank you.
Did you want to ask a question about community?
No.
Okay. Great. Okay. Great. Thanks very much. I'm now going to bring in Willie.
Thanks again, Convener. Joe, I wonder if I could just stick with the scrutiny function for a moment, and I've got a couple of questions on that. I mean, it's a new deal, it's a new arrangement, it's enhanced representation, let's say, with our COSLA colleagues. Does that not imply that there could be or should be a rebalancing of the scrutiny function? I know, as a member of the Public Audit Committee, that we do get some sight of the Accounts Commission and Audit Scotland's reports about performance within our local government, but it's by no means the same degree as the scrutiny that the Parliament has direct directly to look at government in Scotland. So do you think there needs to be a little bit of a rebalance there in the scrutiny function, or are the mechanisms that are all in place sufficient?
So I don't think it's unreasonable that those bodies that Councillor Hedlow mentioned earlier that carry out independent scrutiny, it's kind of wider than the Audit Scotland and the Accounts Commission, but that they just can check their processes, and I think the Accounts Commission in particular are likely to do that. But I do think it's really important that those of us with a democratic mandate to serve our constituents in this Parliament respect the democratic mandate received by local councillors in their elections. And I think that's a really, if we can all sign up to that, then we can have appropriate scrutiny. You know, if there's a policy area which is shared, then let's get those lines of accountability. Let's challenge the Scottish ministers for the policy areas that we've set. But ultimately, it would be for local government to be challenged by their electorate on the decisions that they're making, and which may very well be different decisions in different localities.
Mm-hmm. Thanks for that, Joe. I'll turn to Councillor Hedl. Just Steve, you know, there is an increased role for COSLA, perhaps in national policy development. So does that kind of lend itself to people like us in this committee in the Parliament seeking to scrutinise that aspect of the work that you do a bit more effectively to ensure that, you know, outcomes in the framework agreement are being delivered? Or are you satisfied that the models for scrutiny that are in place at the moment are sufficient to achieve that?
Well, I would say at this point, we are satisfied that we are have appropriate scrutiny at present, but we recognise that this is a work in progress. I mean, we overtly recognise it in Section C of the Verity House Agreement on the accountability and assurance aspect of it, where we say that Audit Scotland and Accounts Commission in Scotland should be invited to support and provide independent evaluation of progress. And we've had, admittedly, very high-level discussions with the Accounts Commission on this already. I mean, clearly, this committee exists and has the ability to scrutinise local government where it sees fit. But I suppose at this point, I would say that it's we have to kind of respect that this is a voluntary agreement between the Scottish Government and local government, and that the. In looking at the way that we're working in partnership, we already have the existing scrutiny that's been applied to us. The way that we work together differently should hopefully mean that things are working better in general terms. Sorry, being very, very kind of vague in how I'm describing this, but you know, we're recognising that this is a journey, not a destination. But I think Mr. Fitzpatrick made the good point that I'll pick up on, which is that the principles that's in the partnership agreement, the Verity House agreement, is underpinned by the European Charter of Local Self-Government, which obviously we're keen to see legislated for as well. And alongside that is the principle of subsidiarity, that that respects the devolution of powers to the appropriate level. So. I mean, I would seek your indulgence for that we don't become too heavy-handed on the scrutiny at this point, and that they give you the assurance that in local government we'll do our utmost to live up to the things that we're promising.
OK. Thank you both very much for those responses. Thank you.
Thanks, William. We're now going to move on to questions from Mark Griffin.
Thanks, Commissioner. Recently, the First Minister has said that any issues related to pay negotiations are one for COSLA, councils and their employees. But, you know, I've been sitting here long enough to have heard previous First Minister, previous Finance Secretaries and local government ministers say the same, only to get involved in negotiations when strikes have caused school closures and rubbish to start mounting. But given that local councils rely overwhelmingly for the vast majority of their funding from the Scottish Government, that funding is spent, and the majority of that funding is then spent on staff wages. You know, what do you see as the government's position to support those pay negotiations, whether that means just getting around the table or putting more money on the table to make sure that local services remain sustainable.
So it is important to re-emphasise the point that local government pay negotiations are a matter for local government, as the employers and the unions, and that is enshrined within the Verity House Agreement, that is the correct procedure, and the Scottish Government shouldn't interfere in that process. However, and I think in line with the Verity House Agreement, in spite of the cuts that the Scottish Government has received, the Scottish Government has already committed to £155 million to support the meaningful pay rise for local government workers. So I guess we've done things differently this year. So whereas maybe in previous years there would be the threat of strike action and then the government would come in and provide additional funding, we've recognised the challenges that you've outlined, and that £155 million of support was provided up front to help support COSLA in their role as the employer.
Okay. You know, one of there's the three key strands of the Verity House Agreement, and one of them is that strand on sustainable public services. Yeah. You know, who has ultimate responsibility for making sure those services stay sustainable? What is a sustainable service if pay inflation reaches the point where public services stop being provided? Are we just talking about services reaching a sustainable level where government and council say, well, we can provide X, Y and Z sustainably, but A, B and C has to go? Or are we talking about providing the existing level of services sustainably? And how is pay inflation impacting on that?
So clearly pay inflation is a real challenge for all parts of the public sector just now. So whether local government, Scottish Government, other public sector authorities are facing this pay inflation, which is driven by the general inflation, the cost of living crisis, these are all challenges which we're having to face in a way that we've never had to experience before in a year, you know, and trying to stay as non-political as I can, but the mini-budget, the impact of that mini-budget is being felt in every part of the public service across Scotland and the rest of the UK. So that is a real challenge. Verity House Partnership Agreement means that we take these things forward together, working in partnership. And the truth is that what is right for one area might be different for another area, and that's how we can empower local government to make those choices, make those decisions, rather than directing from central government. Then hopefully we can make choice, we can allow local government to make choices which will have the biggest impact on their local area. I mentioned earlier about my local authority, Dundee City Council, in terms of the choices they made at the budget last year to put extra funding into supporting anti-poverty measures because of the particular challenges that we see in the city of Dundee. And, you know, there's already a huge amount of money being spent mitigating Westminster policies. And that's money which, if we didn't have to do that, could be deployed in different ways. But, you know, Dundee took some difficult decisions not to do some things because they thought that these things were really important, and it's absolutely appropriate that kind of decision is made by the politicians at a local level who are elected by their constituents to take those decisions, rather than being directed by the Scottish Government in order to make life easier when we're in committees like this and answering questions.
Okay, thank you. And Councillor Heddle, is it possible for local government to meet that key commitment of the Verity House Agreement to sustainable public services and meet the demands of local government staff when it comes to their pay claim?
Back to the fundamental question and, you know, our principle that local government should be adequately funded, and that includes being able to pay our workforce in a way that is equitable across the public sector and with other areas of the public sector. So our ability to be able to do that depends fundamentally on how much money we get. And obviously the next budget is going to be crucial for that. No, I must absolutely acknowledge the £155 million worth of funding from the Scottish Government that Mr Fitzpatrick alluded to, that has enabled us to construct a pay offer to our workforce that we believe does match the other parts of the public sector. But, you know, this is obviously a solution for this year, and it's a solution that is yet to be accepted. In fact, it's been rejected. And it's clearly it's a hot topic for local government, and we'll have a special leaders meeting to discuss this very afternoon. So it's undeniable that, returning to your question, the overall quantum is fundamental to the services that we can provide. And I freely acknowledge this is true for the Scottish Government as much as local government. But if local government's not adequately funded, ultimately we'll not be able to do everything that we want to or everything that we need to.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks, Mark. And we're going to I'm going to bring Miles in with a range of questions to kind of wrap us up.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, I have a couple of questions with regards to scrutiny over the New Deal, specifically the refreshed role and remit of the Scottish Government place directors. Prior to this, the committee has had no engagement with place directors. They seem to have been misplaced for some reason. So can you outline their roles and how you envisage that working in practice, and also what opportunities there's going to be now for Parliament to scrutinise this additional role they'll have?
So, place directors are something that's been around for a while. They try to understand and promote and support how public services work together. And, you know, that role has been reinforced in the Verity House Agreement. But it's, I guess I wouldn't expect place directors to be accountable directly to this. It would be quite strange because they're doing a piece of work. They're not making decisions as such. But, Ellen, do you want to maybe just... I guess you're a police director for some place.
Thank you very much. I am indeed. I'm a co-police director for Renfrewshire, actually. So police directors are formerly known as location directors, so you may have heard of them in that terminology, but they are senior civil servants who are appointed alongside a regular job to be a liaison, to be a point of contact, to participate in community planning meetings and other meetings with local councils and local partners, and to have regular engagement that they're able to both feed into local government but also to take back that local intelligence into Scottish Government as part of a range of discussions. I think we recognise that role has varied over time. It's had more focus, it's had less focus, it works really well in some areas, much like your discussions earlier on community planning partnerships. They're very much a part of that process too. So again, a very deliberate choice, like the community planning references, to bring that in to this to the engagement mechanisms within the Verity House Agreement to reinforce that role, to give it a place, to give it more emphasis, not saying it works brilliantly, but explicitly referencing that we need to look at how we make the most of that. And it much like with community planning partnerships, if we didn't have them for the Verity House Agreement, we would have had to invent them to be able to have that maximum impact and that soft intelligence locally. So that's why they're situated there, but recognising there's much more to build on.
Okay, thank you for that. And it's maybe something we'll want to follow up on in terms of how that's taken forward. The New Deal does state, though, that the Strategic Review Group will provide assurance that Scottish and local government are maintaining all commitments set out in the agreement. So I wondered what opportunities there will be for scrutiny of that group's work. For example, will it be required to publish progress updates at regular intervals, for example?
So I guess, first of all, the Strategic Review Group isn't something new. It's a meeting of the Deputy First Minister and the COSLA President, which generally looks at all matters of shared interest. So I guess the outputs from that would probably be more normally scrutinised through other parliamentary channels rather than directly through that channel.
But I can add to that, yes. So the strategic review group was actually something that we established following the last Scottish parliamentary election. And the current Deputy First Minister was then also Cabinet Secretary for Responsibility for Local Government and took a view we needed to increase our formal engagement mechanisms to create a space on a really regular basis for those discussions about issues that were being that were coming up, to provide an escalation route if things were challenging, but also just to have that really focused space to discuss our key priorities like poverty and how we're working together to advance those, not to replace any of the portfolio or thematic groups that did already exist elsewhere, but to provide that overarching dialogue and engagement. So we took a decision that we needed to continue that as part of the Verity House agreement and to bake that into to the agreement as well.
Okay, thank you for that. I think maybe it'd be useful if we had a sort of flow chart over how these strands all connect as well. And with regards specifically with the Verity House agreement, it reiterates a commitment to incorporate the European Charter of Local Self-Governance into Scots law. So I just wondered if you could outline to the committee what timescales you expect that work to be completed and any parliamentary timescales that be needed as well.
So obviously we absolutely remain committed to supporting Mark Ruskell in bringing forward that bill to the reconsideration stage, and the Verity House agreement makes it absolutely explicit that we are committed to the incorporation of the Charter. In fact, the Verity House agreement draws largely on the Charter in terms of the language that is used, just because the European Charter is not enshrined in domestic legislation doesn't allow us to work to meet the aspirations of that legislation, which was an aspiration of clearly of this Parliament. Obviously, Mr. Ruskell took the view that we should wait until the UNCRC bill was taken forward for reconsideration, and we've now had that announcement. So we will be continuing to work at pace to bring the bill back for reconsideration too. It is a complex issue. We need to make sure we get it right. But it is an absolute commitment, and it's one which COSLA will raise at virtually every opportunity, because it's really important to local government that we have that enshrined in law for the future. And I hope all members agree that is really important that we take that forward.
That's helpful. And if you could keep the committee updated on that, I think that would be useful.
Sorry, I just wanted to bring in Councillor Heddle in case he had any responses to any of the questions.
Yes, thank you very much. Can I just return to the place director point? I think this is a very useful provision in the Verity House agreement, and it's clearly related to the paragraph 6 in the same agreement around the community planning partnerships, where it says to be recognised as a critical mechanism for alignment of resource locally focused on prevention and early intervention and delivering our shared priorities. And the Scottish Government will ensure that these public bodies that can contribute to community planning play their part, including in involving third sector and community bodies in promoting and improving wellbeing. And I think this is where the police directors come in supporting or encouraging the agencies or agency partners to progress in terms of alignment of budget and policy to support the work of and within the CPPs in terms of police. And I think that this committee recognised already that agency partners need to be empowered to do this. So I think this is going to be a key area where they will come in.
Thank you for that. I think we'd agree with you. I think it's just the scrutiny role of their role in that's important for the committee to consider as well. And just finally, I wanted to ask with regards to local governance review, could you say a bit more, Minister, with regards to your plans for concluding the review by the end of this parliamentary term? And is it still expected to result in the local democracy bill being laid during this current session?
So as Tom Arthur said in the last session, you'd expect to get the output from the local governance review by the beginning of next year, or early next year, I think is the language that he used. He's leading on that. It's a really important piece of work ongoing in relation to that Democracy Matters conversation that's ongoing now, but equally there is important work ongoing in terms of looking at single authority models, particularly around Orkney and Western Isles, and I think Argyll and Bute Council are looking at whether that works for them too. And that's one of the things that I've been saying to local authorities when I've been going around. You know, if there's something that you kind of think that maybe wasn't going to work 2 years ago, and clearly that's where Argyll and Bute were a few years ago, and you want to look at it again, then don't hesitate. So I think Argyll and Bute are likely to come forward with a single authority model that they think might help them in terms of getting to that sustainability going forward, and these need to be worked through and in partnership, and then hopefully that will allow us to make those changes. Any of that, we wouldn't expect them to be carbon copies, so I think if there is, does end up being three single authority models, I would expect them to be unique and each one working for what is right for each of those areas. But I know other island authorities, particularly Shetland, are of the view that's not a route they want to take, and they talk about the partnerships and the way that they've developed partnerships under the current arrangements, and we'd hold those up as exemplars. So I think there's a lot of learning to be done. Any changes we make around this, I think other authorities will be looking to see how it all works, and mm-hmm. you know, even if we don't end up with a single authority, hopefully the work in looking at that will help us improve the sustainability of public services as a whole.
Yeah, thank you. And in terms of that single authority, we had very constructive discussions when we were up on Orkney around their plans for that, but it wasn't quite clear where any future funding formula discussions, if that happens and if councils do move towards that, would take place, especially with regards to health funding and council funding. Mm-hmm. Is there any work taking place around what that would look like?
I think that there's work looking overall, but I think you're probably jumping three steps ahead in terms of getting there. But clearly that's part of the work that needs to take place. But equally, in terms of how accountability for matters which are Scottish Government ministers' responsibility, how we resolve those things. And we'll do that in the spirit of partnership that is enshrined in Verity House, and hopefully that will help us take that forward in a way that works for everyone.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Miles. That concludes our questions. I think it's been a very useful session. Sounds like you're having a good, so far so good, constructive relationship. The trust is there, and that's tremendous, and we look forward to hearing updates on how things are going. So thanks so much for all of you coming in to give evidence today. And thanks actually to the Minister and Councillor Heddle for giving a long session. You did well. So we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next items of the agenda in private. So as that was the last public item for today, I now close the public part of the meeting.